Just a little background, Rural Ground Aid was founded in 2019 by a group of Democratic General Assembly candidates running in rural districts in Virginia, including Christian Worth here in the 24th. It was, and Lindley should feel, and Jenny should feel free to correct me or add anything if I'm about this that I'm missing. At the Rural Ground Game was an effort to pool resources after the state Democratic Party basically failed to come through with needed support for rural candidates. The executive director is Ian McNally, who some of you may remember from past statewide coordinated campaigns. Lindley is the campaign director for the Rural Ground Game. She lives in Rockingham County and has a small farm there, and has two small children and a number of animals. she has served as chair of her local Democratic committee and on the campaign staffs of multiple Democratic candidates, and on multiple statewide coordinated campaigns. Jennifer Kitchen, who is, I think, just joined as the fundraising director for Rural Ground Game, and I'm sure you'll be hearing more about their fundraising as the evening goes on. She was the Democratic House of Delegates candidate for the 25th district, which includes parts of Rockingham, Augusta, and Albemarle County in 2019 and again this year. There was one thing that really impressed me that Jennifer posted on her Facebook page when she was running this past September. It was about the 100th anniversary of the Battle of Blair Mountain in Virginia.
It was on my birthday.
Okay.
And it was on NPR
congratulations.
Today.
Congratulations. I don't know how many of you are familiar with that history, but it was a very brutal and violent strike involving mine workers in Appalachia. And it was brutally suppressed and really drove a deep wedge in the labor movement for this area, which I think we're still haven't quite recovered from. She made the point that, let me quote her. she made the point that we are living in the shadow of Blair Mountain. Unions never recovered here, but a lot of great things have happened as a result of the battle too. The union gains of the 1930s and beyond, including many aspects of the New Deal, would never have been possible without the sacrifices made by the Appalachian miners in 1921. And she also made a really important point that the conflict meant that Appalachia was subject to a massive corporate smear campaign, the disparaging hillbilly and redneck stereotypes. That was all invented by corporations to shift public opinion. People who think it's hilarious to trash rural folks should keep in mind that they're basically just perpetuating anti-union propaganda. I just want to say a word about the right to work law that is currently suppressing unions in Virginia. Some of you may remember that in 2016 there was an effort on the ballot supported by Ben Klein and other Republicans to enshrine Virginia's right to work law in the state constitution. which was defeated. And what was interesting, especially interesting to me, was that so many of the counties in the 6th District that normally vote heavily Republican voted against this measure. They voted against making right to work, so-called right to work for less is what I call it, part of the state constitution. So the point is most of Klein's constituents don't hate unions as much as he thinks they should. And I think unions really need to be an important part of any effort to build democratic strength in this district. And so anyway, that's just what I wanted to say. And I'll turn it over to Lindley and Jenny.
Thank you, Jean. Are y'all comfortable with me unmasking while I talk? How are we feeling about that? I'm vaccinated.
I think.
Is that okay with it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Much easier to talk.
Thank you so much, Jean, and thank you all for being here this evening. I think Jean covered most things. I did have a slide deck, but I would rather just not do that. I would love for this to be a really interactive conversation where we're receiving input and suggestions and feedback from y'all. But I would just like to go over a few things just so you have a clearer picture of what we are. So like Jean said, in 2019, we got our start out of necessity. Delegate races and state senate races that year were told that to buy into the coordinated campaign and get that support, it was a $50,000 price tag for House of Delegates and a $70,000 price tag for state senate. Definitely not something that was going to be accessible to any rural campaign.
I raised $30,000 that year, so it was not accessible, not realistic at all.
Exactly. So being rural people and very community oriented, we essentially created a co-op. And in 2019, Rural Ground Game functioned as a co-op. So every month, each campaign paid a set fee to Rural Ground Game, and what they got in return for that was staff. But rather than having to carry the financial burden of paying multiple full-time salaries, all campaigns were paying for access to first one, then two, then three full-time staffers, all with multiple campaign cycles of experience in rural Virginia specifically. So they got assistance with a four-phase targeted field program. So all of their direct voter contact was organized. They were assisted with volunteer training resources so that when we're, you know, working with volunteers, they have a clear understanding of what we're asking them to do. We assisted with digital, finance, operations, and we did bring someone on that helped with communications. So what that looked like was preparation for debates, interviews, opposition research, and then just punching up ads that were gonna be on TV, radio, newspaper, all the places that we talked to people. So 2020 kind of dropped everything to make sure that Joe Biden was elected. And thankfully that mission being accomplished, we looked to 2021, and that picture looked very different. In 2019, rural candidates, even those that didn't raise enough to be able to participate in the coordinated, were still raising a significant amount of money and able to access a lot of tools and resources and to buy into Rural Ground Game. In 2021, Democrats, you know, were feeling pretty worn out, living through multiple years of trauma. And worn out from years of Trump and then now the pandemic as well. The fundraising really was sluggish. And our response to that as an organization was to become a PAC. I know. I think eventually all PACs should die in a fire. But we got to work on campaign finance reform first. So we are now a Virginia PAC and a federal PAC. And we became a PAC so that we were able to fundraise ourselves and then provide our services to campaigns this cycle for free as an in-kind contribution to them. Because we fundraised ourselves, it meant that we did not really get a start until very late August, September. That's not great. It's not great at all in any race, in any locality, in any district, but especially in rural communities where we really need to be fully engaged year-round and start our campaigns much earlier. However, we were able to offer assistance to 18 different campaigns this cycle. We helped some school board races, board of supervisor races, but the bulk of the campaigns, Commissioner of Revenue, we won that one. but the bulk of our campaigns were at the delegate level this year. And while I think we were able to do some meaningful work this cycle, I believe deeply that we have to start much earlier to be able to reap some benefit. A couple of things I'd like to point to in 2019. In our 2019 races across the Commonwealth in 2019, Democrats saw a statewide 2-3% bump. We took the majority, obviously. That was great. But the rural ground game races, as compared to rural races that operated outside of the rural ground game structure, our races saw an 11-point electoral bump. So we know that we have a system and services that actually have a real meaningful impact on the margins. And if you look at what happened this cycle, it has always been morally bankrupt to leave rural communities behind. But I think what we just found out, finally, is that it is also electorally unsound and unsustainable. And because of that, maybe we're finally in a moment where our party will recognize the necessity of engaging in the communities that we live in, and hopefully getting to a place where we are expressing appreciation for the communities that put food on our plate, right? We want to eat on a regular basis. It'd be nice if we were showing gratitude and appreciation for the people who make that possible and the people who keep our lights on. So going forward, we would like to, we have a plan and list of services, and I've got some hard materials, like hard copy materials that I can send to Jean to share with you all, so you can just have in your hands the list of services that we provide. But going forward, what we'd like to see is direct support to rural Democratic committees who would like our help by looking at the list of services that we can provide and essentially serving as your staff. We will never be anywhere as a party without our volunteer infrastructure. We are entirely dependent upon the work of our volunteers, but I do think our volunteers need bolstering. I think we can do much more if you are able to say, this is what our committee wants to do. Lexington Rock Dems just ran this very cool newspaper ad mm-hmm. about Mr. Klein, Jean's favorite. That's a great example of something that we would like to contribute to. So Lexington Democrats have put that out. We would like to serve as a pipeline to ensure that other committees in the 6th Congressional District are seeing examples like that. We don't see it as our role to tell y'all what to say. That is not the space we want to be in. When people wring their hands and are concerned that Democrats don't have a message for rural America or rural Virginia specifically, I don't think that's true. I think we've been running incredible candidates with powerful messages, but they haven't been amplified or organized strategically on a more regional and even statewide basis so that people can hear that message and that it resonates with a larger audience. Jean's idea is a great one. There's currently an effort in far southwest Virginia in the 9th Congressional District to buy up a whole bunch of billboards with a wonderful message, kind of holding Morgan Griffith accountable. And I think there's a lot of opportunities for us to be taking up space that we haven't taken up. And I think there's a lot of opportunities that come out of as a result of COVID, because we've had to find ways to communicate with each other, unfortunately, over Zoom and engage more electronically. We have in 2019 a really nice piece that came out of our co-op that year was that we had a Slack workspace. All of our candidates and campaign staff participated together on that in that space. We workshopped our messaging. Our candidates had a weekly call where they got to know each other a little bit, got to vent, got to troubleshoot, got to work through the challenges our campaign staff. Also had a weekly call where we sometimes vented about our candidates and tried to, you know, strategize around the challenges that we were facing. So we have a new space that is very much like that, and the idea is to open that up more broadly to rural Democrats in general. It hasn't really got up and running yet, which is why I've tapped people like Evan on the shoulder to ask that's something that we work on over the next few months, and anyone in this room is certainly willing to participate there. One of the ideas is that we will workshop some of our messaging, definitely talking about labor unions. I absolutely could not agree more with Jean that when we're looking at how to move a lot of people, we're seeing a lot of really hopeful movement in our labor movement right now, both nationally and here in Virginia. I think there's a lot of spaces where one of the first things I did when I got started in organizing was use my child's colored markers and a huge sheet of butcher paper, because I have a lot of that, and drew a web of all the grassroots organizations just in Rockingham County and Harrisonburg. And then I expanded that out through the Valley. These are groups working on environmental issues, on immigration issues, because we're a welcoming community in Harrisonburg. We have a lot of immigrant communities. All these issues that are pieces of the larger Democratic platform. I think a perennial problem for rural Democrats is that we often feel very isolated. We often feel alone, and the purpose of that exercise was to help me recognize that we aren't. There's a lot of people in our communities who share our values, and I think there's a lot of work that we can do directly with them to cultivate both a bench of candidates far into the future, while trying not to make the mistake of only focusing on our candidates, because our candidates need a community of support around them as well. So making sure that we're really intentional about training volunteers, training folks who are active in their committee about how to operate Vote Builder and how all the many things that it can do for us, and bringing new tools to the table. We have a bunch of tools that we would like to deliver to rural Democratic committees and train you on how to use them as much or as little as you want, but showing you what we think the impact will be. And making sure that we are strategic, that we have crafted a plan for one out to the next 7 years about what success would look like. We'd like to partner with rural Democratic committees and have them all kind of, write out some goals for the next 3 to 4 years and see where we get. We are Virginia, so we are unique in that we either get to or have to have an election every single year, sometimes more than once a year. And because of that, I think as rural Democrats, we have maybe a heightened responsibility to figure out how to move the needle in our communities. The United States Senate map is never, ever, ever going to be strongly in the hands of Democrats if we can't figure out how to do this. Following the most recent election, I've been on calls with rural Democrats in upstate New York, western Texas, Oregon, Georgia, North Carolina, Minnesota, Nebraska, Ohio. We've had interest from people who would love to see an organization like Rural Ground Game assist them with campaigns. For now, what we've said to them is that we'd really just like to hunker down in Virginia and be here and do the work here. But there's a real hunger to participate with rural Virginia Democrats specifically, because we get to test our results every year. And I think that there's a lot that we can learn and be intentional about capturing that data, capturing impactful messaging, and be able to package that and share it as good partners and allies with Democrats beyond Virginia.
One thing that's become very clear in having these conversations with other people, while the places and the names change, the story is exactly the same. So we are very uniquely situated here to work out all of these details.
Yeah, for sure. So I would love to open it up to questions and comments. I don't want to just sit here and talk at you. If anything's been confusing about what Rural Ground Game is, I'd love to just take those questions, but I don't want this to be a lecture. I'd much rather this be a conversation.
Please feel free to make a fundraiser.
Yeah, I was just gonna throw out, so I was one of the campaigns, one of those first campaigns. I would not have known what to do without Rural Ground Game. The assistance that I got was amazing. I had a volunteer campaign manager that cycle. And this last cycle, I was able to run a different type of campaign. I was able to raise a little over $250,000. Wow. So we know that we can raise money for rural Virginia. It is out there. People are excited about getting this work accomplished. People from across the country are excited and investing here. We have a $50,000 fundraising goal for December. That is going to help us hit the ground running in January. As soon as all of the committee reorganizing is done, we want to hit the ground, talk to new leadership, and figure out who wants to come on board and start developing a committee growth plan and a committee field plan, because those are the things that we really need to do to start engaging with the larger community. So that is what that money is going towards. It's helping us do outreach and then helping us provide committees and then later campaigns with the tools they need to be successful.
One of those tools is Statewide Vote Builder, which is $30,000 a year.
Each house campaign, each of us ends up paying $1,000 a cycle just for data that we helped collect. Yeah. So we want to be able to help people get that access to the data, because you can't run a successful campaign without it, as early as possible. Because the sooner you can get started with that outreach, the better off you'll be.
I will put a link to